Hello and welcome to Legal Basics with Cyril Law Global. My name is Sian. We are on season 2 of the Employment Law series, and as we said last time, we're going to try as much as possible to answer all the questions that you've been asking us. So one of the questions that popped up in the feedback was that people wanted to know what happens when a person resigns, what rights they have at the point of resignation, what happens when they've been pushed to resign, and then we decided to deal with the issue of voluntary and involuntary resignation. So today we have an expert on board to help us to demystify these issues. I'm so excited because our guest today is a person that I think I've known for a long time. We can carbon date this friendship. But aside from that, I think he's a very knowledgeable person and probably the most hardworking lawyer I know. So I will let him introduce himself.
Thank you a lot, Sian. My name is Anthony Leshan. I'm an advocate of the High Court of Kenya, practiced for about 7 years now. I practice at the law firm of CMS Daly Inamdar Advocates. CMS Daly Inamdar Advocates is based here in Nairobi. We are also based in Mombasa. We have an office there. But we are part of an international network with over 75 locations in over 40 different countries. So for the people who are looking for legal services in other countries, we are able to link you up with the right people for you to, you know, get your services.
Wow, we call them Ivy League firms. Ivy League. So anyway, Mr. Leshan, karibu to the broadcast.
Asante.
Please define for us what is voluntary resignation, what is involuntary resignation, and maybe at the same time also define for us what is a constructive dismissal.
Okay. So these terms that you've used, they are used in the context of an employment relationship where there's an employer and an employee, and there's an underlying contract, okay, for provision of services in exchange for salaries or a wage. So resignation is just one of the ways of bringing that contract to an end. And so what happens is when an employee feels that it's time to bring the contract to an end for whatever reason, okay, what they can do is to notify the employer that I want to bring this employment to an end. So resignation is a notification to the employer. You can do it in writing, you can do it orally, okay, because you see, a contract of employment can be written or even oral, okay. But it's always better that it's done in writing, okay? So the obligation of the employee who is looking to leave or to terminate the contract is to give the employer notice that I'll be leaving at a certain point. The period of notice depends on the contract itself. If an employee is the one, if under the contract, sorry, I beg your pardon, if under the contract someone is paid on a monthly basis, the employee should give the employer at least a month's notice, okay?
Okay.
If you are paid, say, in every 2 weeks, okay, then the notice period should be at least 2 weeks. So you, the notice period is dependent on the period after which you're paid your salary. But that's the minimum. You can give 3 months notice, even if you're paid on a monthly basis. So really that's the obligation of the employee, to give notice, sufficient notice, to enable the employer
to replace them,
you know, to make adequate arrangements for replacement.
Okay.
Yes. So that's
voluntary.
Okay. So we have the other segment where it's involuntary resignation. And this can occur where the employer, you know, has made circumstances or the environment, the working environment, very intolerable for the employee.
Okay.
Okay. Or the employer has breached a very fundamental term of the contract of employment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So in these instances, the employee may feel justified to mm-hmm. walk away from the employment.
Okay.
So he resigns.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
But he has not done so voluntarily. He has been forced or compelled to resign. So that's involuntary
resignation.
Or what we call constructive dismissal.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Other people will call them constructive discharge.
Okay.
So the terminology may vary,
mm-hmm.
but the point is you've been forced to walk out
mm-hmm.
of the employment relationship as an employee. Okay.
All right.
Yeah. So that's the definition.
Okay.
Yeah.
So when a person goes to court and claims that I resigned, but it's because the employer made it impossible for me to work.
Yeah.
Maybe they're harassed,
yeah.
or maybe they're not being given the right equipment.
Yeah.
What are some of the things they need to prove in that court of law for the court to come to a finding that this resignation was involuntary?
Okay. So constructive dismissal or involuntary resignation,
mm-hmm.
you know, that's a wrongful way of bringing a contract to an end.
Sure.
And the wrong is on the part of the employer
for
making circumstances so difficult for the employee. So what the employee would need to do first, if you're going to court, okay,
mm-hmm.
I think one important thing they need to realize is that in Kenya, there's a time limitation. So you must make sure you go to court at least within 3 years.
From the date of resignation,
okay?
Mm-hmm.
So once you go to court, and another important thing is which court are you going to? I think it's important for our viewers. We have a number of courts.
Sure.
The one that deals with employee issues is the Employment and Labor Relations Court. That's where you go to.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So when you go there, you have the duty or the obligation to prove that you are compelled by circumstances
mm-hmm.
to resign from employment. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So you have to bring material that shows the court that this employer breached a fundamental
mm-hmm.
okay
mm-hmm.
term of the contract.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So it shouldn't be a minor breach.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
A fundamental one.
Mm-hmm.
And even if you can't pinpoint a particular clause in the contract that was breached
mm-hmm.
fundamentally,
mm-hmm.
You can come to court and say, hey, life was made very difficult.
Yeah.
For me, and mm-hmm. I can give instances for the sake of our viewers.
Yeah.
The employer might transfer you from a branch or from a particular location to another in circumstances that were meant to victimize you.
Mm.
Okay.
Mm.
You know, if the transfers are too frequent.
Yeah.
1 month you're here, the next.
You're in Lodwar.
Lodwar.
And then Mombasa.
Know, in circumstances that are meant to victimize you,
mm-hmm.
you can resign and say, hey, I was.
This is not tenable.
Yeah. Or sometimes you're at an executive position in the company.
Mm-hmm.
Then your employer tells you now you'll be reporting to someone who is beneath you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you're
it's humiliation.
It's humiliation.
Yeah.
It's degrading.
Mm-hmm.
You know. So there are quite a number of different things that can happen.
Mm-hmm. Does this include things like harassment at work?
General harassment.
Mm-hmm.
Sexual harassment.
Yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes it's not the employer who's instituted it.
Mm-hmm.
So it could be someone within the organization who's harassing you,
yeah.
but the employer lets it go on.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, that is a good ground for, you know, claiming mm-hmm. to have been pushed out of employment. So you need to to the court, you need to bring material that shows a very strong degree.
That you're pushed to the wall.
You're really pushed.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
And so what the court will do is to try and analyze and place a reasonable person in your position.
Mm-hmm.
Would a reasonable person faced with those circumstances
mm-hmm.
have opted to resign and walk out of the employment relationship?
Okay.
So it's an objective test that the court will have to take.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to be able to show the court that, yes, there are these circumstances.
Mm-hmm.
They forced me to resign.
Mm-hmm.
I resigned on this date.
Mm-hmm.
Without a resignation,
mm-hmm.
there's no constructive dismissal.
You can't just say, I stopped showing up at work,
yeah,
and this means I resigned. Yeah. Yeah. For the employer, there has to be.
There has to be. So the employee has to resign.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So in this work of ours, mm-hmm, sometimes we deal with employees who are still at their workplace.
Yes.
And then the things that are happening, yeah, make life very hard.
Mm-hmm.
And they're at that point where they ask you, as my lawyer, would you advise me to resign?
Yeah.
So depending on the circumstances, sometimes you advise your client, this one, you need to resign.
Yeah.
And then sometimes you advise them, no, for this one, if you resign, it's not a very safe place for you to resign. Just vomilia or try to try to talk to your boss or try to bring this to their attention.
Yeah.
Now, when a person voluntarily resigns, let's say if I'm an employer and today somebody gives me their resignation, what do I do at this point? How much do I pay them?
Mm.
And then if a person now involuntarily resigns, when they go to court, what are they asking for?
Mm-hmm. Okay. So from the perspective of an employer, if an employee comes and gives you a letter saying, you know, I intend to terminate this relationship 1 month from today, okay, so they've given you notice of the intention to resign, you have the option of course, you can't really
force them to stay.
Yeah, you can't force them to stay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you can try to persuade and try and find out what's the underlying reasons.
Mm-hmm.
You know, is it something we can change? You have that option. But if the employee has decided they're leaving, you have no choice but to accept.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the fact that they're going to leave. So what you have as an employer, as an obligation to do, is to make sure that they are paid their salaries up until the last date of employment. Okay?
Yeah.
You have the option. Sometimes the work environment, it's a very sensitive place, the material you're dealing with.
Mm-hmm.
You're not comfortable, you know, with this employee remaining here.
Yeah.
So you can waive your right to notice as an employer.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? You're entitled to 30 days notice, for instance.
And say, let me pay you for those 30 days. But since you don't want to be here, let the security escort you out.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So no need for you to be here for 30 days. You can leave today. You can leave in 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
So you waive your right as an employer to notice.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But when you waive it, you have to pay this employee
For that period of time.
Yeah, for the period of time that has been waived.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
I think that deals with your first question.
Yes.
The second one was...
When you go to court and say that I resigned, but I was pushed to resign, what finding do you want the court to find, and what are you looking at in terms of damages?
So what finding you want the court to make is that, one, a declaration that this termination was unlawful, okay?
Okay.
So even though you're the one who wrote a letter and said I'm resigning, we deem it that the employer forced you out, terminated that contract by their conduct.
All right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So you want that declaration.
Mm-hmm.
And in terms of remedies, there can be about four different kinds of remedies.
Mm-hmm.
One is notice pay, what we call payment in lieu of notice.
Mm-hmm. Was it paid?
So sometimes when you're resigning,
especially
if you're leaving immediately.
Yeah.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
You're saying, look, circumstances were so bad, I had to leave immediately.
Yeah.
Ordinarily, I would have been entitled to 3 months' notice or 3 months' pay in lieu of notice. So you ask the court for that payment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So the notice pay will be a minimum of 1 month.
Mm-hmm.
But if your contract allowed for more, you're entitled to ask the court for
that period.
Yeah. For pay up to that period. So notice pay.
Mm-hmm.
Compensation, or, you know, what lawyers would call damages.
Yeah.
Okay. For unlawful termination.
Okay.
And this can be anything up to 12 months gross pay. So your gross pay per month times 12.
Wow.
It can be anything up to that. It can be 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
It can be 3 months pay.
Mm-hmm.
So the court will look at the circumstances and the conduct of the parties.
Okay.
You know,
so 12 months is maximum.
Yeah, that's normally the maximum you can get.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
There are other remedies, mm-hmm. such as, but these ones you really won't ordinarily be asking for.
Mm-hmm.
Things like reinstatement. You can't be, yeah. you can't ask the
You
court
can't be to, the one that went away yeah. and then tell and the court, be, no, because you're be. Here, I want to come back.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, you can't ask for
So reinstatement kind of is classically not an order yeah, that a person will include yeah. in a claim yeah. for
Yeah, it will normally be financial involuntary. Compensation,
mm-hmm.
Which is classified into damages mm-hmm. and compensation for mm-hmm. unlawful termination and notice pay.
Okay.
Ordinarily. And of course,
mm-hmm.
your costs of the case, which are
mm-hmm. you
know, before being forced to come to court,
mm-hmm.
Those are costs that you can ask for. I think it's important for our viewers also to recognize
mm-hmm.
that especially for those who do not have the funds to go to or do not wish to go to court,
mm-hmm.
you have another option.
Mm-hmm.
There's normally a labor office
yes.
wherever you are.
Mm-hmm.
You can take your complaint to the labor officer.
Yeah.
Now, remember for court, we said go within 3 years.
3 years.
For the labor office, do it within 3 months.
Okay.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So the labor officer will call the employer.
Mm-hmm.
So he'll have to hear both sides
mm-hmm.
and then we'll give an opinion mm-hmm. on what is the best remedy or way of solving this issue. It's just an opinion that they give.
Okay.
Yeah. But if you're not happy with the labor office, you can always go to court.
All right.
Yeah.
I'm sure the viewers are wondering that now that we said damages or compensation is part of it,
yeah.
what are the attitudes of the court towards this? Mm. How much are they giving?
Yeah.
What evidence are they looking for?
Yeah.
Maybe we can discuss just a few cases
yeah.
to give just a feel of what
yeah.
of what the courts need
yeah.
and what the courts are giving yeah. employees who've yeah. been unfairly terminated in this way.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So considerations that the court would take,
mm-hmm.
you know, it's on a case-by-case basis. The circumstances of termination, you know, as many as
yeah,
the employees
yeah. Yeah.
are,
mm-hmm.
okay?
Mm-hmm.
So there's a range of factors that a court would look into, the conduct of the employer,
mm-hmm.
the conduct of the employee.
Mm-hmm.
You know, sometimes employees, you know,
unreasonable, yeah, yeah, yeah.
difficult
yeah.
for themselves. So,
mm-hmm.
conduct of the employee,
mm-hmm.
Has the employer offered any sort of compensation?
Mm-hmm. Have they reported this thing that they say is makes the workplace untenable?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Has the employee taken any steps to mitigate their
mm-hmm.
losses? Because
mm-hmm.
if you're forced to leave employment today
mm-hmm.
and you resign,
mm-hmm.
But you had a number of other offers here
mm-hmm.
on the other side,
yeah,
if you refuse to take them,
yeah. That's your problem.
You failed to mitigate your loss.
Exactly.
So we can say, look, while you have given you 12 months pay.
Yeah.
There
was an opportunity right
yeah,
there.
Since you had an opportunity within 2 months of leaving.
Yeah. Why didn't you take it?
Yeah. So mm-hmm. we'll reduce your.
Your compensation.
To 2 months. Yeah. So it's a range of factors that the courts.
Okay.
Can take into account. Yeah.
All right. So maybe yeah. just as we wrap up,
yeah.
In this COVID pandemic situation,
yeah.
It has really maybe yeah. just made the employment scene a little bit messy.
Mm-hmm.
And when the COVID pandemic struck,
yeah.
some employers let their people go, promising to call them back and saying business has hit a dip. Our hotel has been closed, for example, or maybe you work for an airline.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have flights anymore. Go home. Mm-hmm. We will let you know.
Yeah.
And then a person has gone home and then it's 1 year. It's 1.5 years.
Yeah.
They're not receiving pay. They've not been terminated, but they don't go to work and they do not know how the future is like. Would this be considered a constructive dismissal?
Yes. Yes, it would. Especially if employees have, you know, there's been no form of consultation.
Yes.
You know,
mm-hmm.
you've not notified them. You've not had a discussion.
Yeah. You've just said, I'll call you back.
We'll call you.
Mm-hmm.
So the employees would be justified in that kind of situation
mm-hmm.
to resign from employment. And if they do,
mm-hmm.
then they have a right to bring a claim
for
constructive dismissal.
Okay, yes. Mr. Leshan.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for coming to the broadcast. We've had a really, really great time. I've even personally learned a lot. The viewers might want you to expound on some of the concepts that we discussed today.
Mm-hmm.
How can they reach you?
Well, if you come to CMS Dali Namdar Advocates,
mm-hmm.
you know, just Google us, you'll get to our website.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we'll put a link with our contact information,
okay.
Our website.
Mm-hmm.
Go to the website, you'll find us there.
Mm-hmm.
You're welcome to come at any point and
mm-hmm.
consult us further.
All right. And if you have any questions for us, sometimes the questions are not even related to the law. Sometimes yeah. Fisiles are just asking me about that guest. So if you have any questions for us, yeah. You can write to us at info@cyroglobal.com. That's info@cyroglobal.com. You can also write to us through our old Gmail address, that's cyroglobal@gmail.com. Before we close this broadcast, we would like to thank our videography crew that is responsible for this great videography work, Mushiri Frames. And then we'll have their contacts displayed on this broadcast. We would also like to say thank you to Jay Ojuma and Company Advocates who facilitated the shooting of Season 2 of the Employment Act. Keep well. Bye-bye.
Thank you.